So during this talk, I'll touch base on several topics, scope of the problem, definition, types of heart failure workup, heart failure treatment, and some advanced management options that's available to a patient with heart failure, as well as some self-care strategies that patient can employ to treat their heart failure. So I was talking to Dr. Campbell a while back, and we were just going about this presentation, and the topic came up were the questions, like, you know, how do we do the question answers? So I took that idea and I said, okay, let's just make this presentation into a question answer sessions. And I just took the liberty to ask myself questions and then give answers. So here is the first question. I heard that the billions of dollars are spent every year in the U.S. for the treatment of millions of patients with heart failure. Is it true? And the answer to that question is yes, it is true. The burden of heart failure in the U.S. is enormous. Okay, some statistics say that estimated 5.7 million Americans more than 20 years of age have heart failure. And the projection shows that by 2030, the number is going to go up to 8 million patients with heart failure. In 2012, we don't have the current data, but in 2012, estimated $30.7 billion were spent in treatment of heart failure patients. We aren't talking about any other condition, just pure heart failure. And looking to this graph here, it shows the patient who are discharged from the hospital with the diagnosis of heart failure. The red is the graph for the women, and then the blue one is for the men. And you can see from 1980 to 2010, the discharge with the diagnosis of heart failure has doubled. It's almost like 2010, more than 1.1 million patients were discharged from the hospital with the diagnosis of a heart failure. And then that's really worrisome. And no wonder why this baby is shocked listening to all these things. And everybody is. So the next question is, what is congestive heart failure? And just textbook definition for a patient is heart or cardiac, as we refer most of the time. Failure is the pathological state in which the heart is unable to pump blood at a rate commensurate with the requirements of tissue, or can do so only from high pressure. So either it doesn't pump blood forward, and if it does, it requires so much pressure to build up before it can do so. So that's a heart failure from a textbook. Now, a little bit of anatomy of the heart. Now, two upper chambers in the heart, two lower chambers. The upper chambers are called atria, and lower chambers are ventricles. And depending upon the right or left, they're right or left atria and right or left ventricle. And here, I have left ventricle and the right ventricle marked. This animation basically shows what a normal heart looks like and how it pumps the blood. It's a smaller chamber, it works very effectively, there is a coordinated pumping function between the two chambers, and it works flawlessly. This is what the normal heart looks like. Compared with this abnormal function of the heart, where you can pick out a difference, obvious difference is being the chamber size, the left ventricle is bigger than the one here, and obviously it doesn't pump as effectively, and you see some blood kind of left behind with every heartbeat. So this is just a basic difference between what a normal heart function looks like and what an abnormal heart function looks like. Now, the next question is, what are causes of heart failure? What causes it? Now, I have listed several etiologies or causes that can cause the heart failure. However, keep in mind, this is not the complete list. I mean, the complete list is enormous. But these are some important things that we should remember because it may be applicable to you or one of the person that you know. And I'm just going to run down the list. The things that can cause heart failure: long-term high blood pressure, heart valve problems, heart tissue damage from previous heart attack, chronic rapid heart rate, metabolic disorders like obesity, thyroid disease, diabetes, nutritional deficiencies like vitamin deficiency, thiamine deficiency, pregnancy in some cases, drinking too much alcohol over many years, use of cocaine, amphetamines, or steroids, use of some chemotherapy agent for cancer treatment can weaken your heart and causes heart failure. Certain viral infection that can damage your heart and cause heart failure. Iron buildup in your heart muscle, and some genetic conditions. So other than the last part, genetic condition, which none of us can change because it's just given to us, we have to live with that. Rest of the stuff, as you can see, some may apply to anybody you know, and that can be correctable, okay? So just wanted to highlight some of the important causes of heart failure. What medical terminologies should a heart failure patient know? Every time you walk into a doctor's office, most of the time, we'll be talking to you with some terminology in our sentences. And sometimes patients get confused, like, what he's talking about. And one of the important key terminology that everyone with heart failure must understand is ejection fraction. Ejection fraction is one of the ways your physician can identify heart failure. And ejection fraction basically is a percentage of blood that is pumped out of the heart with every heartbeat. It's a very simple concept, okay? Percentage of blood that is being pumped out during every heartbeat. And as you can see here, the normal heart pumps out about 50 to 70%. It's never 100%, okay? Every time I talk to a patient and they always uses the reference value as 100% and gets scared when I say, oh, yours is 50%, and they say, oh my God, it's half. But that's not true. The normal heart pumps about 50 to 70%. When the heart muscle gets weaker, the pumping ability decreases, and then so the number drops down, usually below 40%. And then this is a terminology, if you want to take it from this lecture, this is the terminology you need to understand, because that's going to be the conversation between you and your doctor every time you go. Now, types of heart failure. In medical books and literature, several ways we define heart failure conditions, and your doctor may use one of these to tell you what's going on with your heart. Okay, it could be systolic versus diastolic, high output, low output, acute, chronic. It could be right or left, or it could be forward or backward heart failure. I mean, there are many ways. This is not a complete list, but just to give you a point that there are many ways a heart failure can be described. So just gonna go and differentiate some of these terminologies. Now, right and left heart failure. So I showed you this earlier that the left heart, or the left ventricle is on the left side, right ventricle is on the right side. So when there is a problem or weakness in the left ventricle is not able to pump the oxygen-rich blood to the tissue. And that creates this left-sided heart failure, or for more practical purposes, since it's being so common, a heart failure. Now, the other same thing happens on the right side. So if the right heart gets weaker, it cannot pump the enough blood to the lungs so that it can get oxygenated. And this creates a situation called right heart failure. But for the majority of the cases, the left heart failure is more prevalent, and for purpose of this talk, that would be the one I'll be focusing today. Now, systolic versus diastolic heart failure. So systolic heart failure involves decreasing pumping function of the heart. It's just the heart as a pump. Just imagine heart as a pump, the amount of blood it pumps out. Now, the weaker the pump, lesser the output of the blood from the heart. So that's a systolic heart failure. The other part of it is the diastolic heart failure. When every pump, I mean, when it pumps, it has to relax to receive more blood into the heart. But if the heart muscle is stiff, it cannot relax enough or properly, and then that creates a diastolic heart failure. The other terminologies that your physician may describe is dilated cardiomyopathy or hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Cardiomyopathy is a scientific word, cardio meaning heart, and myopathy means weakness in the heart muscle. So here is a normal heart, and here is a hypertrophic heart, and you see this ball thickness. I mean, this muscle is so thick and they don't work effectively, okay? And then the last diagram here has a chamber that's really big and enlarged or dilated. So that's, these are kind of self-explanatory in a way. Now, what are the symptoms a typical heart failure patient may experience? And the common heart failure symptoms includes one of the most important things, shortness of breath. It could happen at rest, it could happen with activity, and activity can be simple things like taking a shower to running two flights of stairs. It could be difficulty in breathing when you lay down in a bed to sleep. Sudden weight gain from fluid retention. This is another thing that the most patients will experience during the course of their heart failure. And leg swelling in particular. Now, the tissue in the body can swell anywhere. You know, the fluid can be retained anywhere in the belly, in the arms, in the back, in the legs. But since the most lower part of the body, most of the time, in a functional person is the leg, you will see a leg swell. Fatigue and weakness, which is also very common. And patients, you know, they always tell us that, hey, I can't do the things that I used to do. I can't, you know, clean my house the way I'm supposed to do or I used to do. And the reason is I just feel so fatigued and tired. The reason is their heart is not able to pump the oxygen blood out to the tissue, and then because the tissue doesn't get enough oxygen, they get easily fatigued. Reduced ability to do exercise, same concept. Inability of heart to pump out the blood and resulting in reduced ability to exercise. Now, persistent cough or wheezing. That can happen because the heart is not able to pump the blood out, so the blood starts backing up into the lungs. And when it does that, it may not happen all of a sudden, because if that happens, then yes, I mean, you would feel terribly short of breath and may call 911, and you should. But it may happen over the course of months or weeks, slowly. And the only thing you would see is that you may have a little bit of cough, maybe dry cough, occasionally productive, and persistent wheezing, which many doctors would think initially that, hey, you may be having asthma attack. Other symptoms that many heart failure patients encounters, mostly towards late in their heart failure presentation, is lack of appetite and nausea. And one explanation that is that the fluid, just like your legs get congested and swollen, the intestine, the lining of the intestine or your stomach gets swollen as well, and then that creates this early satiety or, you know, just lack of appetite. So these are some of the most common symptoms that the patient with heart failure encounters. How heart failure is diagnosed? So here is a list of things that can help to diagnose the heart failure. Now, anytime you go to a doctor's office, I mean, your doctor may administer some of those things and to find out what's going on. And detailed medical history is really of importance, like, you know, to differentiate viral cardiomyopathy or whether you had a chemotherapy or you drink too much alcohol, things like that. Physical exam is really important. Is some cases almost equivalent to a diagnostic test for us. Okay, how engorged is your neck vein, the swelling in the legs, listening to the lungs or the hearts, and so forth. Some of the tests that can help diagnose heart failure, chest x-ray that shows congestions in the lung fields, because like I said, the weak heart doesn't pump blood forward, so it backs up into the lungs and lungs get congested, that which can be seen on a chest x-ray. Blood tests, there are specific blood tests that can be done to assess whether you have too much fluid buildup in your body or not. Electrical tracing of the heart, or EKG, which all of you are going to get today, it shows the electrical system of the heart. Ultrasound of the heart, or echocardiogram, it's just like the baby ultrasound that most people know, or any other ultrasound. It's a harmless, just an ultrasound test, but it does show us a really great information. And to me, I think that's one of the cornerstone of diagnosing heart failure. And x-ray of the inside of the blood vessel, or arteriogram, or coronary angiogram, heart CAT, or simply CAT, different part of the country has a different nomenclature, it seems, for the patients. But basically, they're just using a dye to look at the heart arteries, take pictures, and figure out where the blockages are and whether the blockages are responsible for the weakness in the heart muscle. And also, the newer modality, like the MRI of the heart, which is really, really helpful. So, okay, here you go. So this is an example of echocardiography. In the corner here, this is a echo tech doing an echocardiogram. So this is the setup you should expect if you're getting an echocardiography. And these are the two images. The one, again, you know, it's kind of upside down, other than what I showed you earlier. So these are the two atria at the bottom and two ventricles on the top, and then the big one here, the strong one looking, is the left ventricle. Now this one is a normal pumping heart. Compared to that, look at this one on this side. It's bigger, it's dilated, and it doesn't squeeze as strong as this one. And then, so that's an echocardiogram for a patient with a heart rate. Cardiac MRI. So again, this is the setup. It's similar to the CAT scan, the machine-wise, but this is what you should expect to see when you walk in for a cardiac MRI. And basically, this is kind of pictures that we get from an MRI testing. And again, this chamber is bigger, and it doesn't squeeze as normal as we would like it to be. So again, this is a scan picture from a patient with heart failure. Now, coronary angiogram or arteriogram or heart cath or dye test. Again, this is the setup you should expect when you walk into a cath lab for your procedure. Screens, tables, cameras, and things like that. And this is the picture that we get. We inject the dye with this catheter into the heart arteries to find out whether there are blockages or not. And as pointed out by this pointer, there's a blockage. You can all see that very clearly. The reason to show you this test and the pictures is that if your doctor suspects heart failure in you or anybody you know, I guarantee you they're going to get one of these testing for sure. Okay, so it's important to be familiar with it. Now, how do you treat heart failure? The cornerstone of heart failure treatment is obviously medications. So I'm going to run down some heart failure medication. One of the most important one is a diuretic, or fluid pill, or water pill. And some examples are Lasix, Bumex, or metolazone. And this diuretic or water pills work in your kidneys to help you get rid of the extra fluid and sodium through the urine. And that helps with the workload of the heart. Other class of medications called beta blockers. And some examples, carvedilol, carvedilol, metoprolol, etc. And these medications work by reducing the actions of some stress hormones in the body. And it also slows down the heart rate as well as lowers the blood pressure and helps your heart, which is already weak. Another class, ACE inhibitors or ARB. Now I would say it's a nomenclature, that's why it's abbreviated. But some of the examples that you may be familiar with is lisinopril or losartan, valsartan. There are a bunch of others, but some of the common ones. These medicines work by expanding the blood vessels and thus reducing the blood pressure and stress on your heart, and you know, improves or helps your heart work a little bit more better. Also, it blocks some neurohormonal mechanisms in the body. Hydralazine nitrates in a combination has been shown to work great in patients with heart failure, especially in African Americans. And they work by expanding the blood vessels and reducing the blood pressure in you know, helping your heart pump out blood better. The nitrates in this combination also helps with the chest pain because it expands the vessels in the heart. Digoxin, one of the earliest medicine to be used in patients with heart failure, still being used in cases. It slows the heart rate down and helps your heart pump blood better. another class of medicine called aldosterone receptor blocker. Aldosterone is a hormone in the body, and then this medicine blocks this action of this hormone. The example is spironolactone. You may be familiar with that. It blocks neurohormonal activation and controls the fluid volume in the body. So all these pills, and they work a little bit differently. In a combination, they help. The goal is simple, to help the heart out so that the heart can pump blood much better. Now, another common question is, why my doctor wants me to take so many pills? As soon as somebody is diagnosed with heart failure, we give you, okay, here you go, 5 more pills. And so that's a common question that's been asked. Now, the rationale for the medication comes from the research trials and observations in the populations. So during the trial of the medications, some medications have shown to prolong the hospital-free lifespan or improve symptoms. Some medication even improve your longevity or survival. So as shown here, the medicines like diuretics and digoxin have shown to improve your symptoms. Compared to this group of medicine, they do improve the symptoms, but in addition, in the research trial, they have shown to improve the survivals. And that's the benefit that we want you to get. And then that's why we prescribe more than one medication in patients with heart failure. What can I do myself to improve heart failure? That's another thing. And you should always ask, because that tells the doctor that, hey, you really care about yourself. Okay, so what can I do myself to improve heart failure? There are things you can do. First, one of the important things, eat low sodium, low fat diet. Why? Because sodium is bad for high blood pressure, it causes fluid retention. Another thing is losing weight, because extra weight can put a strain on your heart. Next thing, stay physically active, because exercise it reduces the blood pressure and reduces the stress on your heart as well. Reduce or eliminate alcohol, because if you drink too much alcohol for a long period of time, that's going to contribute to the weakness in heart muscle if it hasn't done it so already. Okay. And quit smoking, because again, quit smoking leads to either weakness in the heart muscle or leads to blockage in the heart arteries, which in turn leads to the weakness in heart muscle. Bad things, so you should quit. Now, cardiac rehabilitation, or cardiac rehab, it's known as, is a structured outpatient program which involves exercise and education. It's not a health center where you just exercise and walk out. It's a supervised exercise and educational program which is tailor-made for individual patient. Cardiac rehab help people who have heart attacks, who have stents put in, who had bypasses, who had valve surgeries. It helps this patient recovers much faster. Now, exercise, hopefully what it does is it improves the symptoms, improves the functional capacity, improves the function of the heart, it improves the hospital-free lifespan, and also improves survival. So this is really important to be part of. Now, especially for the heart failure patient, if you have chronic heart failure, or if you know someone who has a heart failure and their ejection fraction is less than or equal to 35%, you should ask your doctor about cardiac rehabilitation. Now, moving on to some of the more sophisticated things, and the question is, my doctor talked about some devices that can help patients with heart failure. Now, give you an example. Weak heart muscle oftentimes leads to abnormal ventricular conduction, which results in mechanical delay and dyssynchrony between two chambers. Basically, what it means that the current that supplies the two ventricles on the left and the right, so that they can beat in concurrence at the same time, has some issue with it because of the weakness in heart muscle. The supply, the electrical current is delayed, so they are not beating synchronously, and that's how affecting the output from the heart.
So what can be done to help solve this trauma? And Dr. Cooper's specialty is bioventricular pacemaker. So he talked about the ICDs and pacemakers are in a way similar to it, involving, you know, the pacemaker leads into the heart. In bioventricular pacemakers, you have two leads in on supporting the two heart and then making sure that the chamber of the heart beats synchronously so that the pump works more effectively. Sudden cardiac death, you heard a lecture about it, so I'm not going to go in too much in detail, but again, as it says, sudden cardiac death, it happens suddenly. Then the way to prevent it is to have the ICD or defibrillator or AICD implanted. And Dr. Cooper talked about it already, so we'll move on. What are the next, or what are the other advanced options for patients with end-stage heart failure, in addition to the management strategies we just talked about? Because we tried the medication, we tried the lifestyle changes, we tried exercise, we tried all these devices, but still the patient doesn't get better oftentimes. So what is the next step for those folks? And as always, a good solution to the failing heart, get a new heart. Okay, it sounds very easy. If one doesn't work, just replace it with the one that works. But unfortunately, we are limited by the supply, not demand. And I'll show you this graph. Since 1998 till 2010, you see the curve is pretty flat. In US every year, we transplant about 1,800 to 2,000 hearts, okay? 1,800 to 2,000. How many patients with heart failure, I said? 5.7 million. And out of those 5.7 million, many thousands of patients who actually are in line to get one of these heart transplants. But only 1,800 to 2,000 folks actually gets it, because there are not many hearts available for transplantation. So this option is an option, and the technology has improved so much, it's a really good option, but it's a supply issue. So what do we do if somebody cannot get the heart transplant? Well, we have some artificial technology that can mimic, not exactly like heart transplant, but at least support the heart. And one of the technology is ventricular assist device, or in short form, VAD. And there are a variety of VADs. The left-sided VAD called LVAD, right-sided VAD called RVAD, or if you have support of both the ventricles or both chamber of the heart, it's called VIVAD. And what it does is that the surgeon implants a pump in your chest that supports or bypasses the heart, and it takes over the pumping function of the heart. There is a power source, like this gentleman is wearing here, outside of the body, and then the power source is connected to the pump through a cable. And then that's a basic setup of a VAD. Again, this technology is useful in patients who cannot have the transplant in the first place, but need one. And the patient who actually are eligible for a transplant, but they are in the waiting line. And then they cannot get it in time, so that they can get this kind of assist devices till they get the transplant. The other technology is a total artificial heart. Just replace both the chamber of the heart, put an artificial pump there, which takes over or replaces, not takes over, just replaces the function of the heart. And again, the reason is the same, patients who are waiting for the heart or patient cannot have the heart, but need one. Now, another question comes up is, are there any devices to remotely monitor and detect worsening heart failure? My doctor asked me to come to the clinic every 2 weeks or every 4 weeks, and it's very cumbersome. I cannot do it. So what are the options? Is there a way I can just sit at home and my doctor kind of gets all the information that he needs without me actually going there? And the research is going in that direction, and there is technology. It's called CardioMEMS heart failure system. It's one of the first FDA-approved implantable wireless device that can do that. It basically has a small sensor which can be implanted in one of the pulmonary arteries. And this sensor doesn't require battery and is designed to last lifelong.
and it continuously monitors the pressures within the heart and indirectly, and it transmits the data through these machines, through these monitors, to your doctor. So your doctor gets this nice pretty graph, and they can detect worsening signs of heart failure very early and adjust the treatment or do something else to prevent you from getting into the hospital, and that way, you know, avoid a hospitalization. And at Erlanger, we are moving towards offering this service very soon. However, this is a technological aspect, but one of the best devices for monitoring heart failure is, anyone knows? Anyone knows other than Dr. Brewer? It's the weighing scale, okay? It's the weighing scale. It's still the gold standard at your home, one of the best monitoring devices that you can have. So if you know somebody who has a heart failure, ask them or gift them for their Christmas a weighing scale so that they can use it, okay? And what do you do with the weighing scale? Okay, I check my weight every day. The ideal time to check your weight when you get into a shower, because you know you don't have the clothes on, so that the weight is more accurate. So that's how you should do it every day. Whether you get into a shower, come out of shower, step on the scale, write down the blood pressure number on any piece of paper or on a calendar, and then see where the numbers track, whether you are maintaining your weight or it's trending down or going up. Take action, report. If you gain more than 2 to 3 pounds in a day or more than 5 pounds in a week, that's a rapid weight gain. You can't eat much to gain that much so quickly. So it must be fluid accumulation in patients with heart failure. A sudden increase in weight means that your body is retaining fluid. Do not wait for the other symptoms to come up. Don't wait for your legs to swell up or you start feeling short of breath. As soon as you see this weight gain, act. Take action. Your doctor may have already told you what to do. They may have told you, hey, you can take a couple of extra water pills if that happens for a couple of days or till the weight comes down. And if they haven't done so, or if you have a question, pick up a phone, call your doctor. Report, take action is the key. Also, from your end, always think about why this happened. Is something changed? Did you miss pills? Or did you eat some high salt food or drink a lot of water that caused this? If so, next time be mindful of it. Okay? You just had a great Thanksgiving, fine. You gained weight. Next time, next Thanksgiving, be aware that it can cause that. So just create that awareness. Now, steps you can do to take control of and manage your heart failure. This is really important. A doctor can prescribe you medication, help you. Eventually, you have to help yourself as well. This is a partnership. This is not a one-way street as far as the heart failure is concerned. The medicine is not the sole solution for this problem, unfortunately. So things you can do, like we talked about, check your weight every day. Avoid salt, salt restrict. I couldn't find a better picture, but actually, the picture should mean that you restrict the water intake. Don't drink too much water, and only drink, you know, as much as necessary. Take your medicines. One of the most common reasons people with heart failure fail their therapy is because they miss the medicines. And sometimes the reason is as simple as having too many medicines to take, and they just get confused and then don't take it right. Come up with a plan, but stick to the prescribed medicines. Monitor your blood pressure. Again, the blood pressure is the pressure against which your heart has to pump the blood, okay? So if you have a very high blood pressure, your heart has to work extra, so you are doing a disservice to your heart by keeping your blood pressure very high. Only way to know is you to check it at home. Doctor's office blood pressure may not be accurate, so you have to record it and report to your doctor. Quit smoking. Exercise. Okay, could be anything, walking, running, treadmill, biking, anything that you can do or you would like to do, or you are able to do. If you have knee problems, you can swim, or you are actually do the water exercises.
don't have to tell you about this picture because it tells you. Okay, really important, not just for the heart failure patients, but for every patient that has any medical problem. Now, just for me, it's easy to talk about. Implementing, it's really difficult. Okay, I get it. I mean, I go through the same thing every day with myself. So it's very difficult, but it's very essential that you should do it, especially if you have heart failure. Okay? You can ask your friends or family to help you out. Just give you my example, personal example, is when my dad was diagnosed with high blood pressure, one of the things that mom came up with, okay, no salt in the house. Nobody liked it for a few weeks. I mean, the food tastes terrible, and I'm from India. I mean, we spice up everything. And I mean, it was just terrible. But we passed through it. Now, if there is a little bit of salt, if I go somewhere and eat, and it's too much salt for me. So it's an acquired taste. You can achieve it, okay? You can change it. It's gonna be hard, but you can do it. Ask our family or friend to help you out with this, okay? There are resources available. You can get cookbooks, you can get exercise plans. There is a website by the American Heart Association, and it's a CardioSmart, okay? So go to that website, you will have a ton of resources, or simply Google it, and you will find resources provided by different hospitals or different organizations that can help you what you need. So find those resources, ask your family or friends to help you out in this difficult time. So the goal is that don't let your heart knock you out in the first round, okay? You should pack a punch or two against this problem. And healthy heart is healthy you, okay? And you should all say it loud, hey, healthy heart, healthy me, okay? And that's the way to do it. So you have to take care of your heart, and heart will take care of you. And that being said, good luck in your future healthy endeavors, and that'll be all from me.